The David Feldman radio program is made possible by listeners like you. You sad, pathetic humps.
Is this really happening? President Obama, you're really going to leave office and let this cretin take over? I guess so. Welcome to the broadcast. I'm David Feldman, DavidFeldmanShow.com. Laugh, listen, learn. That's our show. We laugh, we listen, and we learn. On today's program, two great comedy writers lighten the load for me. Dave Sirus. You might have seen his work on Saturday Night Live and Triumph the Insult Comic Dog. Bob Powers comes by. Brilliant, brilliant comedy writer. Bob Powers. And then later in the show, I'm going to play you two clips from my radio show. One is a conversation with Jenny Rowland. She is a research advocate and writer over at the Center for American Progress, where you should go every day. Her most recent piece there is entitled How Exxon Won the 2016 Election. I'll link to it on the website, but you should definitely check out AmericanProgress.org. And we're going to look at Trump's cabinet through the prism of ExxonMobil. Pretty edifying. You'll see that Rex Tillerson, who I call Rex Spillerson, who Trump wants to be Secretary of State, he's the former CEO of ExxonMobil. People are shocked that we would put the head of ExxonMobil over its state, especially since the State Department is in charge of things like the Keystone Pipeline. In order to have pipelines that run from Canada to America or from Russia to Turkey, you need a Secretary of State to approve all these pipelines and sign treaties. And it's very interesting that the head of ExxonMobil is Trump's pick for state. But what you'll learn from my conversation with Jenny Rowland is that Rex Spillerson may be a red herring. There are a lot more ExxonMobil moles being planted within the Trump administration. Good chance that Rex Spillerson may not even get confirmed, but there are a lot of people who are on the take in bed with ExxonMobil and are about to serve in Mr. Trump's cabinet. This will be very edifying, and you'll look at his cabinet a lot differently after you hear this interview. And then we're going to talk about Mad Dog Mattis, Trump's, some would say, surprisingly good pick for Secretary of Defense compared to everybody else. He's surprisingly good. Mattathias Schwartz is a national security reporter for The Intercept. He writes for The New York Times Magazine and The New Yorker, and he's going to talk to us about Mr. Trump's pick for Secretary of Defense, General Mattis, and why maybe it may not be as bad as we think it might be. So a little optimism. Stay with us. We have a great show. Welcome to the broadcast. I'm David Feldman, DavidFeldmanShow.com. Please friend me on Facebook. Follow me on Twitter. Alex Brazell, we're coming to you from Showbriz Studios, and my producer wants this to be a short show, but this is the week that Mr. Trump takes over, right? And we're saying goodbye to Mr. Obama.
Yeah, leaving with dignity.
Leaving with dignity. Best president of my lifetime. Maybe, well, anyway, let me tell you, this show's going to go a little long, Alex. So you're going to keep giving me the finger because we have a woman from American Progress who's going to filter the Trump cabinet through the prism of ExxonMobil, and it's going to blow you away. I just finished that interview. Rex Spillerson, the new Secretary of
Tillerson,
State. Spillerson.
Oh, yeah. Okay.
Rex Spillerson from ExxonMobil. Red herring. May not even get to state. Mm-hmm. They are using him to distract from all the other cabinet picks who are in the pocket of ExxonMobil. And what they're about to do to the planet, what they're about to do. Listen to this interview. It's going to come on after our roundtable, our week in review.
It's a visual joke, but Tillerson literally looks like a Thomas Nast drawing of a banker.
Who is Thomas Nast?
He was the greatest political cartoonist ever. Like, he looks like a— I said Tillerson looks like—
Did he draw Boss Tweed?
Yeah, he was the guy who like invented what Santa Claus looks like, did all those horrible anti-Irish cartoons of the
right.
of the early 20th or the early 20th century. And he every banker he ever drew is what Rex Tillerson looks like. One of those giant necked guys with like a sack of money.
Right. Google Lee Raymond.
Mm-hmm.
Not right now.
Oh, okay.
Lee Raymond was the head of ExxonMobil before Rex Tillerson. And the guy, there's no face. It's just a big jowl. Just one, not two jowls. It's just his face is a jowl. It's like Jabba the Hutt, Jalba the Hutt. And you look at them and you know they you know, it's like Roger Ailes, the head of Fox. They can't get it up. The only way they can get it up is through kind of rape. You know, it's kind of it's like a power thing. It's not making love. It's fisting with Viagra. They're using their penis as a fist.
That would make less sense to me if I hadn't recently read all the Roger Ailes, the ways that he what he was sued for and how he was harassing women and how it was all power based. And just when you picture what Roger Ailes looks like, it's so much harder to read.
Yeah, that's how you filter your politics. When you're ugly, when you're fat, bald, ugly, you smell bad. Roger Ailes smells bad. He's rotting inside from the steak. And the idea, he's smart enough to know that no woman would ever bed him unless it was...
That's why it has to be a power thing. That's why it has to be your Roger's whores.
Right, and that's not love. That's not sex. That's rape.
I feel like he left the concept of true love behind a long time ago.
Anyway.
God, this started out pretty toxic.
Here's the point I want to make. And I want to introduce the show. And we're going to talk about what's going to happen this week and where we're at. And I have dyslexia. Not real dyslexia. But I'm a lefty, left-handed, and I don't watch TV news. So I don't know what you, because you watch TV news.
Yeah.
I get all my information by reading. Mm-hmm. And I've realized in conversations, it's a form of dyslexia. Because everybody else is on the same page. Because they're getting the official propaganda. There's the boys on the bus. Literally, they're on these reporters are all on the same bus, and they're creating a narrative that everybody jumps on. I don't accept that narrative, so I don't. So the more I read, the less I know what's going on. And here's the point I'm making. I'm going to read to you from Ralph Waldo Emerson.
Okay.
And this is the mission of my show. I'm going to read this. This is what Ralph Waldo Emerson wrote, and this is going to be the mission of my show this year. Ralph Waldo Emerson wrote, there are 850,000 volumes in the Imperial Library at Paris. If a man were to read industriously from dawn to dark for 60 years, he would die in the first alcove. Would that means it would be great if some charitable soul, after losing a great deal of time among the false books, and delighting upon a few true ones, which made him happy and wise, would name those books which have been bridges or ships to carry him safely over dark morasses and barren oceans, into the heart of sacred cities, into palaces and temples. Emerson's wish is that it's impossible. This was pre-internet. This was the 19th century. And he was complaining about the 850,000 volumes in the Paris library that make him feel stupid. And he said, wouldn't it be great if somebody could read all those books and tell me what to read? That is the purpose of this show. I can't read the entire internet, but I will only surround myself with people who do. Like you, Dave Sirus, great comedy writer, SNL.
Oh, thank you.
Triumph the Insult Comic Dog, great stand-up comic. You're undefeated.
At Roast Battle, yes.
Roast Battle. You don't get on this show unless you're reading and you have insight. The only way we're going to survive the Trump administration is if people put down the clutter, put down the noise, and focus on what's really important. Stop with the Facebook. Stop with the video games. Stop with the Star Wars and Three Broke Girls. Stop watching television. We're about... This is the inflection point right here. Trump is a gift. I'm a big moon guy, Apollo guy. I'm obsessed with Apollo. And Gene Kranz said, or maybe it was Deke Slayton, when Apollo 13 was dying, when the Aquarius was dying, and we were going to lose the crew of Apollo 13, he said, I think this will be NASA's greatest moment. And what do we remember? With all the moonwalkers, who do we remember? We remember Apollo 11 and Apollo 13. In fact, more people know the story of Apollo 13.
It's a better story.
It's a better story, and it was NASA's greatest moment. They didn't make it to the moon. They didn't make it to the moon. And I think this is an opportunity. It's a gift. Trump is a gift. This can be America's finest moment, where we finally pay attention to democracy, even if our president won't.
Well, it's finally something akin to Vietnam for the liberals to gather around. Because liberals, when they don't have a common enemy, turn on each other. Turn on each other so fast that it's infuriating. And Trump could be the only thing that is so horrifying that they actually wisen up and act like a team and start fighting.
Now, one of the reasons I have people like Dave Sirus on, and Bob Powers is late, but we're going to start anyway, because Alex Brazil and I feel a fight coming on with my producer today. I just feel it. There's tension in the air, and I know he's going to tell me to shut up. I know it. The mission of this show is to tell you what's important, what to pay attention to. That's the mission of this show. Don't let them throw dirt in your face, because that's what Trump is great at. Steve Bannon, these guys are going to be overwhelming you with little things to get you upset so you don't pay attention to the important stuff, the real stuff that's going on. I'll be quiet in a second, okay? But I'm consumed, and I have a mission, and I apologize for sounding insane. But I am insane. We're not going to pay attention to the red herrings. We're going to focus on what they're doing in Washington, D.C. Okay.
Which is what Hillary should have done in her ad. She should have, which I think she wanted to. I think that people saw what she was doing as making sense, using the logic that up until this election worked, that people care about personality, not policy. And people don't care about policy in this country. The people who care about policy are looked at like dinosaurs, because we actually paid attention to what's going to happen if which person wins. And it's amazing, because people think that they can look at someone and decide who's going to be a better president based on character, based on looks. But if you think that that's what you should vote for, you automatically aren't qualified to judge anyone's character, because it means you're too lazy to really look into who they are. You're making a snap judgment on someone and saying, who would I rather hang out with? Well, you know what? If you're the average American, any president who would want to hang out with you really shouldn't be president.
Mm-hmm. Well, you know,
does Trump actually want to hang out with these people. That's what they're so delusional about.
You know, I saw this, the Curtis documentary on the BBC called Hypernormalization. Have you seen it?
No.
Maron recommended it. Come on in, Bob. Maron recommended it.
Hey, we just started.
Hey. Hypernormal. Bob Powers, great comedy writer, and feel free to... I have a fantasy about Bob Powers.
Yeah?
Should I step out?
No. I'm going to tell you what my fantasy is about Bob Powers in a second.
Can I tell you mine after?
Yeah. Who I think you are, and I've decided it's going to...
You're going to throw away who I am and stick with your fantasy.
Yes.
I prefer that.
I saw Hypernormalization. Mark Maron represented it. Yeah. He sits and watches. It's on the BBC. It's this guy, Curtis, who does these documentaries. They're polemical. I love it. It's mostly style over substance. It's great. It's BBC, and it's mind-boggling. And it's the guy read 5 books, and he found a connective tissue. But it sticks with you because it's art. And this illusion of the thrust of this, hypernormalization is that we were manipulated into retreating into ourselves after the 60s and focus on self-improvement. Jane Fonda, he says, it's great. Jane Fonda went from trying to stop the war in Vietnam to building your body properly and getting into shape. And we're all now, you know, face down in Facebook and Twitter, and we have all these tools to express ourselves. Meanwhile, the financial industry, Wall Street, is stealing our government, has stolen our government. That's one of the messages. And I just want to say to the people listening, you've been given a lot of tools. You've been given Facebook. You're a publisher on Facebook. Everyone's a publisher now. Everyone on Twitter can make their voice heard.
It's a really good argument to bring back elitism.
Not elitism.
In some ways.
It's an argument to stop expressing yourself, stop being an artist, shut up, listen, and learn.
Yeah, which I think of as, honestly, elitism, because elitism was the idea that only certain people were smart enough to do these things, and people really resent that. And that's a big part of why people voted for Trump. They reject not even the elitism of intelligence, the elitism of knowledge, the elitism of education. They believe that basically anyone who wants to be at a certain level should be, and that this idea that you're smarter is an artificial construct.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I'm an idiot. All my life, I've been an idiot. And I look at Bill O'Reilly. It starts with Bill O'Reilly. He couldn't cut it at CBS News. So they created a network for him, Fox News. But he's an idiot. Mm-hmm. Hello, Bob Powers.
Hi, David.
How are you?
Hi, Dave.
Hi.
We met
good.
Neil deGrasse.
I'm sorry I'm late.
That's all right.
Yes.
We met Neil deGrasse Tyson.
What an idiot. Am I right? I could do what he can do.
When you meet somebody who is so obviously better and brilliant than you, there is that instinct to, want to crush his skull. You don't need cans.
I don't need the cans.
You don't need the cans.
Oh, yeah, you're not wearing cans. Okay.
You want to crush his skull, or you can just go...
Or slurp the insides out.
Slurp the insides.
Yeah.
Drink it.
You can ingest intelligence now.
What is your reaction when you meet somebody who is so obvious? We're adjusting a microphone here. And I'm getting some chiropractory done.
My reaction when I meet someone
who's incredibly more brilliant than you are.
Do you want me to...
Somebody like Dave
You're
Sykes.
Saying you want me to... Oh, I was going to go there. Okay. my reaction is generally to listen to what they're saying, let it just sort of wash past me, not understanding a word of it, and occasionally go, oh, wow, because I know I'm not going to engage in this conversation in any meaningful way that they're going to remember, so I'm just going to occasionally make a noise.
I just realized how bad a person I must be for the fact that I can't immediately think of a time that's happened to me. And I'm like, oh, my God, I have a serious narcissism problem.
Well, you've never met anybody who you go, oh, my God, this person is so much...
No. I honestly felt that when I met Robert. Because one of those things where when you grow up loving
Robert Smigel.
Yeah, to be honest. I hate to say that, because I don't want him to hear that. But yeah, no, I did feel that. And I didn't really feel that with anyone I worked with at other jobs, even though they're people I absolutely respected, there was no one I ever had that, wow, I'm getting to work with this guy,
That's true. Yeah, I've never had that before, Robert, really. I don't think.
Well, I mean, we're all equal, but all of us have our own gifts. I have a gift of logorrhea, diarrhea of the mouth.
Mm-hmm.
That's my gift. Neil deGrasse Tyson, who we hung out with, is an astrophysicist.
So you both bring something to the table.
Right. And... Yeah, I don't know. Maybe it's a function of age where you meet somebody who's truly brilliant and you just go, okay, I'm going to listen.
Well, he does
so much. You've never met anybody like that? Robert?
I'd say so. I mean, if I met Neil deGrasse Tyson, I would be very impressed with him. Like, I think him and Bill Nye are people who do so much important work for the society. They are like two people who are just holding up this crumbling dam of logic, and there are so many people who want to replace what they do with just emotion.
Mm. Yeah.
And we know who those people are.
Yeah. I mean, Obama, I think that the problem that he confronted is he's just better than everybody.
Yeah.
And the Republicans couldn't accept that.
With Trump, my thought was that everyone who voted for him, or a lot of people who voted for him, were sick of presidents being smarter than them.
Yeah, exactly. And I think with Obama, there's a lot of resentment.
And you know, that's a great line, because I'm actually not insulting the voters. I'm saying that they are smarter than the man that they voted for, even though I'm still calling them stupid.
Well, they
don't know that yet.
With Bush, at least you could say, well, he's got, you know, he's not really stupid. He just came across that way, which is maybe bad at that job. Whereas Palin was someone who people were openly celebrating her stupidity.
Right.
They were saying, what do you mean it's bad that she shoots wolves and rides snowmobiles?
Never reads.
Yeah, and people would say that, like, I do that. And it's like, do you think you could be president? Oh, my God. Like, they really think it. These are people who think the job of president is to yell. They think that, like, there would be more jobs if they just went to the congressional floor and said, make it already or I'm going to punch you in the face. Like, these people think that's the entirety of the complexity of this job.
Uh-huh.
The will, the strength of will to make it happen.
Yeah.
And that is friggin' terrifying.
Yeah, the strength of will.
Yes, I did choose those words specifically.
Mm.
You know, I feel like as a Jew, there are certain terms that I have full license to use that I think only we should use. That's why, like, when the primaries were after the primaries ended and Hillary became the nominee, and I felt in reference to people who were not on board with her, you know, because, you know, after she won the primary, I often use the term, it's time to pull out the long knives. Because as a Jew, I have a right to use every Nazi term.
Well, Bob, what do you think we need to be doing? Because I said before you got here that
I think putting more Nazi terms back into the public discourse is definitely on.
Is it Godwin's law? Godwin's law is the minute you bring up Adolf Hitler, you've lost the argument. That any
oh, really?
Conversation will eventually
go. Godwin?
I don't know, but no. It's Godwin's law that
some Nazi.
Anytime you get around, if you have a conversation and somebody will eventually say it's Nazi Germany, and then you've lost the argument.
I think
that used to be irrelevant.
That used to be now a good argument. Now it's like, we really got to make sure this isn't Nazi Germany, guys.
Yeah.
Let's be watchful about.
Why have we been saying never again my whole life? If when it happens again, we're just going to say, okay, you know what? Just let it happen.
When someone's just using the playbook, it's okay to make some comparisons now, you know. We're not saying he is. He's not yet.
He's much more of a Mussolini than a Hitler.
Right.
Never.
Well, let's give Hitler some credit. He didn't have nuclear weapons at his disposal. Donald Trump does.
And Hitler knew how government worked.
Yes, and he served in the military.
And he was popular.
And he understood architecture.
Yes,
that's the thing I'm clinging to with, like, all of my hope. A lot of times dictators are popular. Putin is like 70-80% popularity. And even when they do research to be like, all right, how much of that is bullshit? How much is people afraid to say that they don't like him? It dropped from 80% to 70% when they discount, like, people who feel pressured to say, yes, he's good. Trump is at 37%. Like, I know polls, we're not supposed to trust them anymore, but there are numbers that, you know, if they can manipulate everything else,
so where is
then they can manipulate
that. Well, the alt-right
too.
Was specifically lying in polls.
Hang on for 1 second. Let me ask you, where is Trump in popularity versus
every other incoming president?
Yeah.
Half.
His
unpopularity is double the normal. Like, normally when a president comes into office, they're at 25% unpopular. Trump is over 50% unpopular. And that is, yeah.
He is not enjoying the honeymoon.
Let me just, if you don't mind, I think I'm not going to correct you, but there's a misconception about Adolf Hitler. When he came to power, his popularity was at an ebb. That the Nazis were much more popular in the mid to late 20s. They did much better in the Reichstag.
Oh, really?
Yes. And they were waning.
Mm-hmm.
And he did not come in with a majority. He was up against von Papen. He was running for chancellor. The Nazis did worse.
Uh-huh.
But they had their brown shirts come out, and they were thuggish, and they intimidated Hindenburg, who was the putative president of the Weimar Republic. And he kind of compromised. Hindenburg kind of compromised and allowed Hitler to be chancellor. He won, but not by the margin.
Gotcha.
And the point of that is you have a minority president, Donald Trump.
Mm-hmm.
And people actually believe majority rules, the same way we believed in 2001 that Bush was a minority president.
Yeah.
And he can be restrained because he doesn't have the will of the people behind him. But what happens is they get so intimidated, Trump and George W. Bush, that there's this nagging thing in the back of their head that I don't have the will of the people, that they seize it.
Oh, yeah. Yes, that's frightening.
But I think that the difference is Bush wanted to be a good president. I think.
Oh, my God.
I don't think he was, but I think he wanted to be.
Yeah. But the people who surrounded him wanted what?
To dominate the earth.
Yeah.
They wanted to basically have a Pax Americana.
Mm-hmm.
They wanted to have a truly. They wanted to basically bring back the America of the time of the Spanish-American War. They wanted to bring back the time when America was just colonizing everything we could get our hands on.
Yeah.
Do you think? I'm sorry. Go ahead.
No, you go ahead.
But do you think? Because we're getting nostalgic now for Bush and Cheney.
Oh, sure.
Fuck
who's,
yeah.
Who's, at least they were competent. At least he was hiring people who knew how government worked.
Yes. And actually, not to keep bringing him up, but Robert brought this up, that he is the only one who constantly is, like, sort of finding the bright side of this, or the hopeful side that
right.
maybe Trump will, like, ruin everything in Washington, so they'll have to rebuild and things will... Not that he... Obviously, we know his politics, but... the one thing that he kept bringing up was Bush and Cheney. Like, Cheney was in there thinking, I know how to recreate the planet, you know? I know where the oil needs to come from, where it needs to go, and everything has to do that. And Trump does not necessarily have anyone like that in his cabinet.
Well, right Mattis seems to be pretty...
He's
Mad Dog Mattis. He's certainly a competent general.
Well read, travels with his
books.
Yeah,
he's apparently anti-torture and stuff. I really don't. I haven't read it.
He's anti-torture, but the new head of the CIA is not. The head of the CIA is someone who has been very vocally in favor of torture up until his hearing.
Pompeo,
right? Yeah. Up until his hearing, he was on the Senate floor congressional floor talking about how important it is that we torture. And only now that he has to get confirmed has he suddenly switched his position on it, which is friggin' terrifying.
He's a congressman.
Yeah.
And Jeff Sessions, the racist pick for...
Mm-hmm.
Justice, he believes that waterboarding is torture, correct?
Yes, I believe. Well, everyone getting confirmed now believes it's torture.
Yeah, they're all just going to flop.
But Pompeo is only getting the CIA position because he previously defended torture.
Right. By the way, at the end of this roundtable, we're running two interviews. One is about Mad Dog Mattis and the Mattis waiver. And the other one is about Rex Spillerson and the cabinet filtered through the prism of ExxonMobil. So you think that Trump...
That's not... He meant to say... He knows it's Tillerson. That's a pun.
No.
See the look.
You're saying later... Were you saying what's coming up later?
Yes.
Oh, okay.
And my lunch is coming up later.
Yeah.
Who's dumber, Trump or George W.
Trump.
Bush?
Sorry, I answered before you finished the question. but I don't think it's even close.
You think Trump is dumber than George W. Bush?
Yes.
Significantly. I mean, I think that people think Trump is a genius, but it's like Trump's manipulating not exactly the geniuses of the country either. I think that they like him because they identify with him for a very bad reason. I think Bush was bad at his job, was very, very bad at the job of being president, but could have been good at other jobs. And I think Bush literally meant well. I think he did what he thought was best for the country. He was just incorrect about that. I think Trump is only doing what he thinks is best to make him look good, and that is the only goal he has. I think the difference is Trump would take a 70-30 shot at looking great versus killing us all, and Bush would not.
What's going on, Bob Powers? You said something at your party. Great Christmas party, by the way.
Thank you.
Very interesting people.
Dave hasn't said it's great yet.
It was a great party.
He said it was an okay. He thinks it's an okay time.
No, it was an absolutely adequate party.
Yeah.
Well, you and I were off in the corner writing jokes to slam Dixon for the roast battle. The man was. Are you, and you're undefeated, right?
Yeah.
So eventually
only
you
three.
Have to go. Huh?
Just three. Yeah.
Three. You're 3-0.
Yeah.
Dixon's 5-0.
Yeah, but
Pat Dixon
against people like you.
All right.
You said, I'm kidding.
You said something that just you just said something that just stuck with me since the party. You said, "Get your hands off my wife's bottom."
I think you misheard. I said put and on.
You said,
"What a nice lady."
You said the country's going through a mass psychosis, and I just can't let that go.
Yeah, I mean, it feels that way to me. All of a sudden, everybody is saying, like, they're just behaving in a way that I don't think that they were behaving as early as 9 months ago. I think everybody is happy to parrot things that they don't believe in order to just...
That's exactly it.
...shout what they... in order to shout the There's opposition
a,
down.
There is a groupthink delusion going on.
Yeah. They think it's fine to, like, when people are like, he didn't imitate a disabled reporter. He didn't do that. It's like, I know, like, I read a few more of your tweets. You're able to form a sentence. I know you don't believe that. You are just fine with saying, like, something that is not true and, like, for a purpose that you're not, like, that is illusory. 'Cause you're not changing anything. You're not, you're just simply engaging with someone who you've never met, and you're willing to get behind something that's a lie, that's fake.
Have you seen the excuse they make for the articles that say they have proof that he wasn't making fun of the guy?
I did that. It was so hilarious.
Like you're really seeing some
10,000 words.
Themselves.
Yes, it's like 10,000 words in order to be like, look, he gesticulated in this video too, and in that video he's like, right. He lifts up his hands.
He's gesticulating, like, and he's moving his arms around, but what he's not doing is bending his wrists and pinning them to his chest to mimic being what you would call like a spastic in the old days.
They find a video of that reporter, I can't remember his name now, Serge, I can't remember his name. He's a celebrated reporter.
Was it Kowaleski?
Yes.
With the New York Times.
Yeah, he's like an award-winning reporter. But they find video of him where you don't see his arms. So they're like, see, he doesn't do that in interviews. It's like...
Well, they said he doesn't shake. His arms are stationary. Uh-huh. And like, see, if Trump was making fun of him, he would have held them stationary, not shake. Because that's the big point. Trump would never inaccurately mock someone for being disabled.
And you don't exaggerate the way you make fun of a handicapped person. Listen, I've done it all the time. The way you make fun of a handicapped person.
We've all been
You exaggerate their handicap.
Yeah, we've all been children. We know how you make fun of someone for being handicapped.
If someone has a lisp, you exaggerate their lisp. But don't do that with my lisp, by the way.
You have a lisp?
I thought
you were gay.
He said you should see this poor guy. He said you should see this poor guy.
I pass for gay.
Oh, you should see this poor... Why is he a poor guy then? If you're not talking about his disability, what's so poor about this man who's attacking you?
I just want to tell them, like, it's... You don't like you're wasting so much time. Like you could be looking for work. You're wasting so much time creating these blog posts. It's like, can't you just be like, yeah, he made fun of a handicapped person. I voted for him anyway. Just live with that. Like,
yeah. So I was at the beginning of the show. I talked about the mission statement for 2017, which is to get above the noise, get above the clutter. And I think you just isolated it. We have to save the planet. There's a serious problem with climate change.
Mm-hmm.
Let the conservatives worry about whether or not he mocked a disabled reporter. I think we need to do what the Republicans do, which is focus on the important stuff. The mm-hmm. Republicans focus on money. Mm-hmm. They know what they want. They want money and power. Right? I mean, shouldn't people...
I definitely think it's a waste of time to get into any of those arguments. And also arguing with anyone who is behaving that way. Like, I feel like instantly just, walk away because it's a total waste of time.
It's a bunch of Jeffrey Lords.
Yeah,
it's people who are willing... People like Kellyanne Conway who are willing to... You know they're lying.
Yes.
You know that they know they're lying.
Kellyanne Conway knows she's
lying. They are just they are just changing subjects and saying things that are crazy because, and they're just going to keep speaking and speaking until you get bored and let them move on.
Yeah.
Can I just say one thing I saw Jeffrey Lord say yesterday about John Lewis? Representative John Lewis said Trump is an illegitimate president because of the election tampering.
Tell us who John Lewis is.
John Lewis is, he was beaten for being a civil rights, as a very young man. He marched Martin Luther King. He was beaten by the police. He is the greatest, one of the greatest living civil rights, probably maybe the best alive, in terms of civil rights activists. And he's a representative. He's been a congressman for many years. And he said that Trump was not a legitimate president, which is not a crazy thing to say based on what all the stuff that Russia did. And Jeffrey Lord said on a news show.
Who is Jeffrey Lord?
Jeffrey Lord, I'm sorry. Yes, he is a lawyer who represents Trump. He's been one of those guys who goes on TV shows and defends Trump like Kellyanne for, since his entire presidency.
He's the one who looks like Cold Miser.
Like you dropped a Muppet in bleach.
Yes. Yeah. He was one of the two on CNN all the time who was defending.
He looks like someone shrunk a head, but only the skull and just left the skin on it.
And he has white hair flying up around his head.
Yes. Yeah, he does look like one of those Christmas characters.
Yeah.
But definitely one you're supposed to hate.
Yes.
So he said, I think it's hypocritical of John Lewis to call Trump an illegitimate president, because John Lewis was beaten by racists in the 60s because they didn't think his skin color was legitimate.
Wow.
And and what made me so mad is the fact that the CNN reporter just said, okay, and then went to the African-American liberal, who was the counterpoint, and asked a question, and it was like, how are you letting that sit there and get into people's brains as if that's not a crazy thing to say?
All right, so here is what I want to do, and I want to spend 5 minutes talking about this, and let's stay focused on it, okay? And this is exactly what you brought up. I want to stay focused on this topic. Focus. Focus. We need to focus on what's important. I started this show talking about Ralph Waldo Emerson, talking about the 750,000 books in the Paris Library, and we need people to read those books and tell us what's in them and isolate the important books. You two are brilliant men. My listeners need to be informed. They're not getting it from CNN. And every time I watch CNN, I say, what a waste of my time. I'm getting no information. Why would you focus on that? Why do you focus on CNN when, in fact, maybe 200,000 people out of 350 million Americans are watching that?
I mean, honestly, it's because I'm watching it, not because I respect it. I'm literally looking for jokes. I'm looking for things to talk about. I'm looking for what's going on. I'm trying to just get every piece of information.
How many hours do you spend watching CNN, MSNBC, Fox News per day?
Maybe two, but it's like, while I'm doing other stuff, I'm just trying to get that information in.
You have it on the back. How many hours do you spend?
I don't usually. I watch it when there's an event going on. If there's a debate, then I will watch their pre-game and their post-game. If there's an event like the other day with the hearings and the Trump press conference, yeah, I had it on. But I definitely don't tune in regularly. I will watch the clips if they become relevant, or if they become viral enough, like the Anderson Cooper with Kellyanne Conway. Did you watch that the other day?
Yeah. No.
That was wonderful.
What was that?
It was Anderson Cooper not allowing. She was finally sputtering, trying to pivot away. Anderson Cooper would not allow her to conflate CNN's release or CNN's reporting of the Trump report, the intelligence on Trump, with BuzzFeed's release of that two-page dossier, and they were trying to do that to discount CNN's reporting, and he just would. It went on for about 12 minutes of him not letting her get away with anything.
She kept saying it was a Russian. It was a Russian who got the information. He was like, no, it's not.
Yeah.
That information, no one has said that until you said that just now. And she kept saying it. She was, there are people saying it. It's like, you don't get to do that.
Okay, and my objection to this, and we're going to have Mr. Rosen on. He's an NYU professor. He writes Think Press. He talks about journalism. Kellyanne Conway is a shiny bauble, a distraction, because CNN, MSNBC, and Fox, CBS, the new, they don't want to do the heavy lifting of real reporting. Every Sunday they have Kelly on Conway, Face the Nation, Meet the Press. And we all, it's Charlie, I hate to use the Charlie Brown and Lucy and the football. This week we're going to get her. This week, you know.
Do you think they're even thinking we're going to get her?
Why don't you?
Oh, yeah.
Why doesn't John Dickerson, why doesn't George Stephanopoulos do reporting on Sunday? Instead of going, you know, being proud that you have access to Kellyanne Conway, why don't you do some reporting, you worthless toads?
Here's a thought that I've had on that, which is with Kellyanne and with Trump. Like, they report Trump's lies, you know? When Trump says, I didn't say that, they report it, and then they're, like, down in, two columns in, or then they, or on TV, they have to ask other people, did he say it? You know, we all just saw, well, they, we don't, it doesn't need to be reported. They report Kellyanne's lies. If you're a reporter and you have a source, and you've used a source, and that source, you found out that source lied, and then you used it again, and you found out that source, like, at what point... Eventually, a reporter who just has an informant will stop using that that source if all the information they feed them is lies. At what point, like, will one of these news organizations just say, we are no longer reporting what Kellyanne Conway or Donald Trump says because we don't use inaccurate sources? You know,
right.
Like, at what point do you keep having to say, this guy I didn't tell at the CIA who I use, everything he's told me is wrong and has come out wrong, but I keep using it. Like, that would never happen if it wasn't an official for the president. No. So can't someone just eventually say, we will no longer report, unless the lie itself is the story, but they don't make the lie.
Jim Acosta, that's his name, the guy from CNN.
Yeah.
Okay. Everybody wants to be a White House reporter. And that's a BS job. You're a stenographer.
Yeah.
If you're a White House reporter, you are just repeating what the president or his spokesman says, and you're fighting for access to get their narrative. That's not a reporter. Do some real reporting. If Trump doesn't want to give you access, Jim Acosta, don't go to the press conference.
Yeah.
Don't ask the questions. Roll up your sleeves. And do some reporting. There are thousands of people in the CIA and in the agencies who can give you actual documents about conflicts of interest. Mm-hmm. That would require you to read and write and report.
Yeah. But
so
would people believe it at all?
People believe it?
We have such a deep
more than half
problem
will
in this country.
More than half will and less than half won't.
We have an extreme gullibility issue in this country that is building. I think it started. I've been talking about conspiracy theorists for years. They are a cancer on our society. They are eroding the ability to parse information. And that's what we saw this year, this explosion of fake news and the gullibility specifically of the right, because that's where fake news is focused, because they buy these things much, much more often. I think that's what this is.
The discussion that we have to have with the other side is, are there two sides to education? Certainly they believe that creationism should be taught in our schools. It's not just fake news. It's really fake education. Are there truths?
Yes, of course.
And
no. And also the other side, when you say the other side, that paints the entire other side. I would say, I wonder how many people even think creationism needs to be taught in this country right now.
It's gone up.
To what?
I would say a majority of people who voted for Trump believe that.
Oh, the Republican Party.
Majority who voted for Trump?
Yes.
Yes. More than 50% of the people who voted for Trump think creationism should be taught in schools. I firmly believe that.
Oh, it's a fact.
So that would be more than 25% of, or more than 24 or whatever percent of voters in this country believe in creationism?
I think a lot more than that.
I've never read on it.
I think it's more like 40% of the country.
40% of the entire country believe in creationism?
40% of the United States is creationist.
No.
Yes. Yes. It's gone up. It started. I just watched this. Bill Moyers did an interview with Neil deGrasse Tyson about 3 years ago. So I know this. It's and they the story that Bill Moyers told was that ever since George W. Bush became president, the number of people believing in creationism versus evolution has gone up. Fewer people. Now, I think more people believe in evolution, but it's like 60-40. And 15 years ago, nobody believed in creationism.
Yeah.
I don't know, man.
No, I mean, I've read, I can specifically read times when I've read over 100 million people in America, I think, believe in a young Earth.
10,000 years old.
Yeah.
So back to the topic, focus, focus, focus. My goal, people say, why do you have Pat Dixon on the show? Well, first of all, he's brilliant. Big problem with him politically, but he's brilliant and funny. Big problem with him politically. My goal is to win his vote. There's an election coming up in 2 years. Get his vote. I don't care who he is, what he think. How do you get his vote? Is it best for us to focus when we go on Facebook and Twitter to attack? My question is, if we're the pacifists, if liberals don't believe in first strike and hitting out, why are we so eager to fight and argue and attack the other side? You talk about Mr. Lewis, Congressman Lewis, on the Pettus Bridge, getting his skull cracked open on the march to Selma. Passive resistance. If we're liberals and we're Democrats and we believe that we're better than the other side, shouldn't we be exercising passive resistance on Twitter and Facebook?
No.
No?
Well, first of all, it doesn't matter what we're doing on Twitter and Facebook. I kind of want all of us to leave Twitter. Twitter wants to become 4chan. Just let it. Like, there will be some, or whatever takes its place. I don't think we're going to change any of the minds that are yelling their bullshit, their fake, who are believing what comes to them on Facebook and Twitter. Those arguments are just anger. They're just the reason I might reply to someone. I generally don't. The reason I might is just because I hate you and you're wrong. And you said something that was patently false. Yeah. And I want to say it's patently false. I don't think online matters anymore. I think what will, if he does not get kicked out of office, if the intelligence community doesn't save us, if the GOP doesn't decide he's over, I think what has to happen is the classic, I think, this, like, streets activism and what happened in North Korea, South Korea, where a million people stood in the streets until she resigned.
Well, I have actually won. I don't like to do it, but I have actually won some arguments on Twitter and Facebook, I swear to God, through proper messaging. You know, you read George Lakoff and you need to know how to message, and it's focus. You have to be focused on one specific thing when people attack you on Twitter and Facebook, and you have to remain on point and ask for hyperlinks. We live in this magnificent time when you can ask for proof. You can ask for evidence, and I'm going to contain my hatred for these people. I'm just going to say this calmly. When you ask them for proof, they send you illegitimate news sources with illegitimate facts and figures that are just patently false. All you can do is educate. All you can do with the other side at Thanksgiving is listen and stay on point. And the point is to win their vote. We want their vote. How do you get their vote. And you're not going to get it by fighting and arguing with them.
I think these are just people who need to go back to not voting at all. Mm. People who need to realize that their ideas are impossible to implement, which they are going to see now. That was the one good thing about Trump winning to me. I wanted Trump to win for one reason while he was running, which was I want these people to see what actually happens when they get their way. I want them to see how this actually works because clearly they're delusional about it.
Well, tell me what's going on. Let's move on and let's talk about ACA versus Obamacare. From what I understand, they've gotten rid of Obama. I'm being funny here because there's a...
Yeah, the thing about that people think that those are two different things.
Is that true?
Of course it is.
Tell me what's going on here.
You are drastically underestimating the stupidity of this country.
There was one that was really viral that I thought was fake, but...
I think it's real.
And I do think that one was fake. Sorry, man. I keep moving away from the mic. I do think that one was fake, but like Sam Levine the other day was saying that there's a website or a Tumblr or whatever with like thousands of these
Sam Levine from Freaks and Geeks.
Sam Levine from Freaks and Geeks. We run in a very rarefied crowd. And he said that they've gathered like tons and tons of these screen caps of people.
Tell me what this is about, what people misconstrue.
That people who are on Obamacare thought that Obamacare was something else, this evil shadow organization. And they're like, no, I'm on the Affordable Care Act. I love my health care. It's Obamacare that's terrible because they're only processing just sort of half hearing things on the news. And they just hear Obamacare bad, but they love this Affordable Care Act. So they just never bothered to learn enough about it to realize, oh, that's just the name the Republicans put on it. Like when Chris Christie said, oh, Obamacare, he named his thing after himself.
No, he didn't.
What the hell is wrong with you?
Nobody's on Obamacare. They're forced to get health insurance.
Yep.
That's it. You have to get health insurance.
Well, you're on Obamacare if you're using the government subsidized one, which is great. A lot of people I know personally had their lives practically saved.
And explain that to me. When it's government subsidized, that means it's Medicaid.
Well, it's not Medicaid. It's like Medicaid. It could have, in my opinion, it could have easily just been called an expansion of Medicaid, but people wouldn't like that because Medicaid is for poor people. So that's not popular. But yes, it's essentially that if you make a certain amount of money, the government pays for part of your health insurance. If you make a certain amount of money, the government pays for all of it, like if you're in California.
But it's not the federal government paying it. It's the state that's paying it.
Yes, but the federal government's subsidizing it, right?
If they accept it.
Right.
So some states aren't accepting.
Well, that's true. Yes,
Medicaid.
My experience with it is only in California, which is obviously
right.
Where it works, where a lot of people are very happy with it.
Right. So a lot of states have rejected the money which goes to their Medicaid fund. Medicaid is a state-run, it's like a block grant from the federal government.
Right, for just poor people to keep them from, you know, dying in the streets.
Well, yeah, but not just for poor people.
Well, Medicaid isn't Medicaid specifically for the poor?
Well,
poor and also just like disabled.
Oh, and
yes, but the plan is to keep people from dying in the streets.
Right.
Who have absolutely no other recourse.
Lyndon Johnson created two programs that have saved, I don't know, billions of Americans' lives. Medicare, which the Republicans opposed. Medicare is so that people over the age of 65. Have socialized medicine, and it works.
And you find me one Republican today who's against it.
Plenty.
Oh, really?
They're trying to privatize.
They're trying to privatize it.
Privatize, but they still no one wants to get rid of it because that's their voting.
Yes, they
block.
Do. That's
privatize.
I'm mistaken. I thought it was a thing where they just wanted to, you know, obviously, like private, but that they would never say. Like they'll say, let's just stop. Helping the poor, they would never say, let's stop providing health care to old people.
No, when they get a loan and they're on record saying they want to get rid of Medicare and they want to get rid of the minimum wage.
Oh, sure. Yeah.
So Lyndon Johnson set up Medicare so that no person over the age of 65 could worry or go broke because they couldn't afford health care. And then he set up Medicaid, which was a block grant to all 50 states. to provide health care to people who were below the poverty line. It was part of his war on poverty. And believe it or not, when Obamacare was passed in 2010, it went to the courts. It was, and the law said that every state has to accept these block grants for Medicaid to subsidize poor people who cannot afford health care. And there are states that say, no, we don't want more money. We don't want more Medicaid. And the Supreme Court ruled that Obamacare was legal, but it was against the Constitution for a law to force the states to accept money for Medicaid. So some states are accepting the Medicaid block grants and others are not. Where it works, where they're accepting the Medicaid, I know a lot of people on Medicaid, and it's saving their lives. And, you know, Medicaid used to, like food stamps, used to be something that we associated with poor people. And you can call them poor people. I call them my friends. I cannot tell you the number of friends I have who are on food stamps.
Well, you've been doing comedy a long time.
Well, and Medicaid. And what was once deemed something, oh, you know, you've run into some bad luck and you're on Medicaid and food stamps. There are a lot of people who are on food stamps and Medicaid. They won't tell you. But a lot of people are suffering in this country.
And a lot of them voted for Trump.
A lot of them voted.
A lot of them did because not because they're, well, I mean, because they're delusional about what he's going to do and they don't listen. They're not listening to what he wants to do. They're just looking at him. It's like, you know, John Mulaney has a good joke about how Trump is like a hobo's idea of a millionaire.
Hmm.
And that's what they see him as. They trust him because it's like, they look at Trump and they say, I get this guy.
Mm-hmm.
I
mm-hmm.
get it. And he, and that means that he must get me. And that is not true.
Right. And I want to get to the issue of winning their vote. Because to me, the human being on Medicaid and food stamps who says, you know, I want the government to stay out of my Social Security.
Yeah.
Those idiots. And we call them idiots. But I want their vote. I want their vote. I want their vote. And I find myself, I catch myself sounding like the mortgage brokers who take advantage of immigrants and stupid people who give them these, you know, subprime loans. And then you go, well, if they're too stupid to figure out a mortgage, they deserve to lose everything.
Mm-hmm.
And I sense in all of us and in liberals and the Democrats a little delight in the fact that people are about to die because they were too stupid and they voted for Trump. We're kind of like the guys who were pushing subprime mortgages.
I think that's inevitable. Look, that's the eggs that have to be broken for this omelet. They made this bed. There is no saving these people. The only way we're getting those people's votes back, is if we go back in time to 1981 and put a lot more money in the education system in this country. We've been complaining about education for 30 years. Well, this is what happened. Mm-hmm. That's all it is to me. I think we need to go back to a time when these people realize they have no goddamn idea what they're talking about and they stop voting for anything besides American Idol.
You're looking like Lena Dunham.
Hey.
You're making me feel stupid.
I'm not trying to...
I know you meant he's making you hard.
Yeah. Lena Dunham, the difference between me and Lena Dunham is
but
I
you
think
have
she,
contempt. So you're a Hollywood liberal with I contempt for... You have contempt for these people.
Yeah, but not just them. I have contempt for most of the people on my side of this, on my side too. I have contempt for people, you know, most liberal Hollywood comedy writers, stand-ups, people in the music industry, people who work in television. I mean, it's not just them. They're just the ones I feel are the most important for me to attack right now.
And that's why we lost. Or we won, but we lost.
I don't think that's why we lost.
I think we lost because of gullibility stemming from the conspiracy culture of this country. And it's a general sense of people losing touch with reality.
We didn't know someone like Trump could pull this off. We didn't know what it's like to have a demagogue run and win. or we didn't know he could win. We didn't know that demonizing like specific groups could work out for you. We thought that that would damn you immediately. We thought making fun. We didn't know. We were naive about what people would roll with.
We greatly exaggerated the common decency of this country, and we did not realize that we are now half internet troll.
And yes, exactly. And also, in terms of voting against themselves, their own interests, demonizing people, everyone on, like, when you're saying no, everyone is on public assistance, no one wants to admit it. I think that everyone everyone in this country wants to say, I wouldn't need a handout if you stopped giving those people handouts. Mm-hmm. You know?
Yeah.
That, like, even though you all need it. if you stopped giving those Mexicans and these refugees a handout, I wouldn't need a handout. I would be fine. But because that's what Trump told them.
And it's both despicable and a lie.
Yeah.
Well, it's a part of brainwashing. And so, do you hate the victim? Because, again, I want to get back to, how do we get their vote? Bernie got it. Bernie had their vote, and they went to Trump. So they were a lot of them. I don't know what the exact numbers are.
Those were the people who wanted to vote for a rebel independent of what they believed. Anyone who went from Bernie to Trump never really paid attention to what Bernie was talking about.
But he got
their
vote. They
just hate the government, and they wanted someone who they thought other government people would hate.
Okay, so I agree with you that we have an education problem in this country, and I agree with you that there's a problem with fake news. You're smart. You're well-read. You need to be a teacher. You need to teach the other side.
I would get fired so fast. My friends have I talked about this with my friends before, and they said if you were a teacher, you'd be a really good teacher, and then it would take a matter of weeks before you said something that we would all think is hilarious but would end your career. And that's true. I wouldn't be able to stop.
See, I think there's a part of Obamacare, ACA, that's brilliant, and it should be extended into our electoral process. With Obamacare, you all have to get health insurance or you get fined. Mm-hmm. In Australia, if you don't vote, you get fined. Hmm. Everybody has to vote in Australia. If you make it mandatory that everybody has to vote, the emotions, which are just plaguing our electoral system, will evaporate. The problem with American democracy is everybody has to energize their base to get them to go to the polls.
Right.
You got to get them angry. See? The only that you have to get scared and you have to get angry in order to get these people to vote. And we make it so hard to vote in this country that you have to be so pissed off on election day to take time off from work. And that's why Fox News and AM radio, everybody's getting they rev you up. Well, if you made it mandatory, if everybody had a vote, people would calm down. They know they're going to vote, and they'd pay attention intellectually to what's going on. Instead, we're in a constant state of fury because that's the only way you can get people to vote.
Well, people demand to be – people said this. Like, they demand to be excited by a candidate. And it's like, you know what? Maybe the president shouldn't be someone exciting. Maybe they should just be competent and keep things – and make things well run. The idea that you need someone who's a giant bombastic showman is really friggin' dangerous. And could you imagine choosing your dentist on who was the most exciting? Imagine picking, like, you know, picking a contractor based on who made you angriest at other people.
Hmm. Well, I was going to bring bagels and cream cheese to the show today.
But you didn't.
Can I eat my bagel and cream cheese?
You can go ahead and eat your bagel and cream cheese.
Turn your mic away.
Yeah. So around the corner, this is always my reaction. I've had this reaction since I moved. That's all right. Remember when Smigel did the show? He was like, We bought bagels and cream cheese. Were you on that show?
No.
Oh, I did a round table.
I heard it, yeah.
Yeah, comedy writers get to talk to Robert Smigel. I made the mistake of giving him bagels and cream cheese, so he's eating bagels and cream cheese. Anyway.
Well, what does he know? He doesn't have a podcast.
Right. And so this is my reaction that I've had since I moved to San Francisco in 1982. I walk into this bagel shop. Alex, they were lined. I swear to you, they were lined. Huh? Yeah, that was the name. Tompkins. Yeah. They were lined up. And my first reaction is the same reaction I had when I lived in San Francisco. I looked at all these young kids, and I used to be a young kid in San Francisco, and I wanted to scream, how can you afford this? Where is your money coming from? Who are you? Why are you lined up around the block for these overpriced cappuccinos and bagels? Where's this money coming from? And probably their parents. There's this great transfer of wealth that's going on. The greatest generation is dying off, and parents are leaving money to their unemployed middle-aged children and their millennial grandchildren who
thank
don't.
Thank God for that.
Well, let me tell you, this is AP reports. This is from the advocacy group Young Invincibles. Millennials earn a median household income of $40,581 a year, or 20% less than baby boomers. That's median household. That doesn't mean individuals are earning $40,000 a year. The household collectively is earning $40,000.
But are they also less likely to be a two-income household?
Hmm?
But are they also less likely to be a two-income household?
They're going to be a two-income household, and these are roommates. Household or roommates, a family.
Yeah.
It could be three people collectively earning $40,000 a year.
I know people with like six to a house that are probably making a total of $40,000.
Oh, wait, they calculate roommates as a household?
Median household. This is our household.
I don't think roommates count as a household, do they?
Not on taxes, but maybe on this.
On a census, who lives here?
Yeah.
What do you all?
Census, yeah.
Okay. Median household income of $40,000. That's 20% less than baby boomers, even though millennials are better educated. Okay, so, and this is based on Federal Reserve data. We keep hearing politicians say, I fear that one day our children will not be able to outperform us. That's the whole American dream of our children will do better than their parents. Folks, it's over. Mm-hmm. It's over. And when we say, well, you know, how did Trump get elected president? Because as you said, we're in a little bubble and we didn't realize the pain that I would say 99% of Americans are in. 99% of Americans are in pain financially. And if they're not in pain, they're lying to themselves. They're lining up for bagels and coffee that they can't afford. And this has been going on since I moved to San Francisco and Reagan became president. Everybody is struggling financially. You know, the millennials are better educated than their parents, but they're doing poorly financially.
It's technology.
It's technology, but they don't perceive. When you bring up Medicaid and food stamps, they're on Medicaid. They're on food stamps. They're living below the poverty line. They have college degrees. They're smart. They don't identify with people who are below the poverty line. They identify with the richest 1% because they went to college. So they're lying to themselves. 99% of America, 99% of America is in a financial crisis, whether they realize it or not. And that's why Trump or Bernie.
The people who voted for Trump for those reasons are people who believe that we could simply return to the Industrial Revolution while the rest of the world destroys us technologically. These are people who think we should just go back to mining coal and let the rest of the world work on solar and nuclear power. that is a delusion. That is a childish, wishful thinking that Trump, you know, he wants to encourage people to believe things that aren't true. That's one of them. The idea that you can just bring back these jobs. We're manufacturing in America. Our manufacturing's fine. We're manufacturing fine compared to the rest of the world. It's just we don't need as many human beings to do that anymore. It's not that these jobs went somewhere else. The jobs stopped existing. And technology does not give a rat's ass about poverty. Yet, we cannot stop technology from creating poverty. Because if we do, we lose. There's only two options. You can either be the technological head of your world and hope the jobs follow and just create the jobs, the new jobs around that, or you can do the much harder thing that no one wants to really talk about but is going to happen. We can really globalize and we can actually be a one world government, which I'm not saying we should do, but are we going to really act like there's a choice besides that?
I love you, Dave Sirus. I do. I want you on this show as much as possible, and Dave Powers, but you lost my vote.
Yeah.
What you just said, I just kept seeing Lena Dunham's tattoos. I kept seeing Rob Reiner's big fat face. You don't care.
No, I just laughed because I thought of Rob Reiner's face.
Yeah.
I think that's realistic.
But you're not putting... I just said to you... I'm not fighting with you.
I'm not trying to be rude. Yeah.
I just said to you that we need their vote. And there's a serious problem in this country, and you're intellectualizing it away. And that is not going to solve the problem, and it's not going to get our side votes.
But if I can interrupt, Bob.
this is Bob Powers. And by the way, you should like Bob Powers because he's not a Jew. Go ahead.
I don't know. They could hear that in my voice. The apparent lightness of my demeanor.
I feel like
he had an interesting childhood.
You're going to tell me the name Bob Powers doesn't imply some kind of escaping from the Nazis? Goyesha Schutz name that they won't think twice about?
Bob Powerreich.
Go ahead, Bob.
I don't think he's... completely just not caring. I think he's acknowledging that there is no solution to get those
Who
jobs.
Who is acknowledging that?
Dave over there.
But there is a solution.
Well, I
hate to use the term solution in front of you.
One problem with the idea of, yes, there are technology has rendered a lot of jobs obsolete and a lot of need for these employees obsolete, and we have to find some other way to get them employed. But one huge illusion about America, the American dream is children will always do better than their parents, hasn't always been the case. And also another illusion is that we should all have a job that we can, like, everyone should have access to a job that they can retire with. You know, you start at the plant at 22 or whatever, and then you retire at 65 or 55. There was a tiny window of America.
Yes.
After World War II,
yes.
when that one little tiny generation could walk into a plant after World War II and keep making cars until about 1978, and then never again. We've all clung to this idea that is in the Constitution, apparently, that we're supposed to have the same job for 40 years. It only happened for like a handful of guys,
right,
like who were born at one specific time,
right,
and died at one specific time. But there are people who started working in 1958 or 64 who got laid off in the late 70s or early 80s.
And right. Even then, even when we talk about that one window where things seemed so great, how come every time I watch a movie from the 60s, everyone seems desperately poor? How come every time I watch a movie that takes place in the 60s, it's always like 30 people in one apartment and they're trying to like scheme to get dinner that night? Like, I don't think people were ever doing as good as we remember.
And the other thing is, it was a great time
for the whites.
Yes. For white men.
Yeah. Yes. The people who weren't, you saw nice lives, boring as fuck lives for people who were white. You know, you saw their little house in the middle of Ohio or whatever, and You know, so you assumed that guy went to the plant and came home and his wife made him dinner. But just on the other side of town, people were absolutely living in just utter inhumanity.
And it's why people need to really adjust their understanding of the economy. We need to have, in terms of the education about the way the economy works, we need to have a national sort of, let's say, night of broken glass, where we all really change our perceptions.
Are you talking about a Kristallnacht?
I mean, yes. I speak English, so I'm saying night of broken glass. I don't know why you're saying that in some other language.
There are like 9 other podcasts that we don't listen to where someone just said that.
But they don't, they're not making the same
context.
Point as you.
Yeah.
No, you're right. I mean, the idea of this economy, it was an aberration.
Yes, it was an aberration. Yeah, and it was because we just beat the entire world at something, and we bombed 2 cities, and hundreds of thousands of men
died
for it. So there
in America, there was a shortage of labor.
Yes,
we didn't hire blacks or women, basically. Mm-hmm. So the supply of labor was,
it's essentially ancient Rome, where people were really happy because there were mostly slaves. So the people who weren't slaves had really great lives.
Uh-huh.
And even bigots who want to say, well, let's go back to that. Let's not hire blacks or women.
That's exactly what they are saying.
They can't even, it won't even work then. We fucked too much. There's too many white men here now. Like, we can't even support that.
We have a glut of bad ideas in this country, antiquated ideas, and the only thing we can do is take those ideas and put them all together on a train to a secluded part of the countryside where they can be systematically and humanely exterminated and replaced with superior ideas.
By the way, that is...
And we'll bring back the gas industry, the vapor.
Well, a lot of these people do want natural gas jobs. So that's a good point, Bob.
Yes.
So think about this. Let me just circle back to this. It's kind of interesting. It's kind of mind-boggling. The civil rights movement of the 60s, which gave more jobs to African Americans and eventually women... Basically, if you believe in conspiracy theories, the richest 1% said, you know, I hate black people. I really do. I don't want them in my office. And I hate women. I think they're really second-class citizens, women. But if we let them into the job market, it'll really bring down the price of labor. You know what? Let's do it.
Mm-hmm.
So that's what happened.
And that's honestly how things get better in this country, when there's money to be made off of it.
Yeah.
That's where racism gets better, because when there's a dollar to be made, that's how environmentalism really only gets traction, where there's some kind of profit people can make. It's never going to be just sacrifice.
So the Civil Rights Act of 64, right? Was passed in 64 and 65. Uh-huh. By 74, we were losing to the Japanese.
Exactly. The Civil Rights Act was at most a temporary solution.
Well, what I'm saying is the Civil Rights Act, 10 years later...
He just got it.
10 years later, it destroyed... once again, black people were viewed as a cheap source of labor.
Yeah. Well...
That's why they passed this. I bet Lyndon Johnson got the industrialists to get behind the civil rights movement by saying, mm-hmm. once we allow more people into the job market, labor will be cheaper.
Well, boy, I mean, we had a labor problem. We had a serious problem with too many Americans simply not creating, not working. We needed to get them out of their, you know, everyone's sitting around drinking instead of working. We need to get them, we need to push them out of their beer halls.
Jesus.
And get.
By the way, as long as you're talking history, Bob Powers, we should stop with the Nazis.
Sorry. That's all the terms I can think of. So I think
I'm certain that's not true.
The Bernie Donald Trump coin.
Yeah.
The people who voted for Bernie
went to Donald Trump.
Went to Donald Trump. The history of populism in this country is, I remember, because I was alive in the 19th century. Populism started, the progressive movement started, because farmers were going broke from deflation and industrialization. And they kind of joined together in Wisconsin and Minnesota and became part of this progressive movement that was racist. That these strains of populism, very contemptuous of African Americans, and so it makes sense for people to go back and forth between Bernie and Donald Trump.
I think those
I'm not sure why Bernie and Donald Trump, because
the original strains of the populist movement
were racist.
So it's people who are downtrodden, who cling together, but only their kind.
Right.
And attended the populist movement came out of Wisconsin, Minnesota, and those people tended to be
white. Do you think Bernie applies?
Bernie was applying scapegoating about the rich the way that Trump was blaming the poor.
The poor, yeah.
And I don't think either of those are entirely accurate. I think one is much closer to accurate.
Mm-hmm.
I don't think this blanket hatred of the rich as if they're this foreign body that's invading our country is exactly an accurate thing, but it's certainly a lot closer to the truth than saying that it's Mexicans, especially when you look at the actual rates of how many Mexicans are entering this country illegally compared to what the fabricated ideas that Trump put out there that tried to just scare people.
No, the original populace hated immigrants because they were taking our jobs
away. You're using the word original, and I don't know if that's really an accurate use of the term, because when you talk about original populace in America, because the original populace in America hated the rich when it was called the king.
Yeah.
And before that, you know, liberal and conservative goes back to monarchist and populist. And people who reject the idea of centralized power and just, you know, and which is another way of looking at wealth. It's just a sort of way of telling people, which are you scared of? Are you scared of the throngs of the poor, or are you scared of the king? And that's sort of what liberal conservative has been in every country.
Well, let me push back on that, because the 1776, that revolution was replacing a king with crony capitalism. These were white slaveholders who were millionaires. George Washington was the wealthiest man in America, and they didn't want to pay taxes to the king, is what that was about.
Right.
And the Boston Tea Party was a revolt against being forced to only buy tea from the king and not from Holland. These were guys who were all about money, and the fear of the minority, this Madisonian ideal of we have to protect the minority from the majority. That was a Virginia plantation owner's fear of a mass uprising from slaves and the poor. When they talk about isn't it great in America how we protect the minority from the majority? He's talking about the richest 1%.
Yeah. The analogy you could use is, what's more popular right now, vampires or zombies? Because those are both allegories. Vampires stories are an allegory of the victimization by the rich, and zombies are about the fear of the poor.
Mm.
And people are a lot more into zombies. I mean, that could just be a storytelling thing. They're just more fun. I don't think it really means. But that's what those both mean. Mm-hmm. You know, a vampire is a perfect example of an aristocrat.
True. Yeah, and zombies are home invaders.
Yeah.
And they're
mindless.
They're people wandering onto your land, and how do I protect myself?
Mindless, starving, low class. Lowest of low class is how
vampires literally suck your blood.
Yeah, and
so
they have power.
We can actually, you're talking about the rich, but we can go with you. I mean,
Tomato, tomato.
Blood comes in.
We have to wrap it up. But before we go.
I got to be anti-Semitic, right?
Mm-hmm. What?
Well, he was saying vampires can either be referred to as the rich or Jews. It works either way.
Oh, I see.
Because I worked in Bloodsucker in there. So.
Yeah. So our show is on every Tuesday and Friday. That's when we're dropping. Thanks to Alex, we've decided from now on every show is dropped on Tuesday and Friday. So we may be a little late with some news that happened on Tuesday morning. Before we wrap it up, I want to ask the listeners to do something on Twitter. Now, I just said, don't fight, don't argue, don't attack. But there's a guy named Bill Kristol, not Billy Kristol. Bill Kristol.
The funny one.
Bill Kristol is the publisher of the Weekly Standard. And he invented the invasion of Iraq. He was behind the invasion of Iraq. He is a horrible human being. Am I correct?
Actually, you're educating me. So
was once a liberal, right?
No.
Wasn't he once a liberal?
No, his father.
Yeah.
Okay. What? Okay.
He's one of the few who backed Sarah Palin
right.
unilaterally.
Jesus Christ.
Like, he actually maybe is responsible for Sarah Palin. I remember that.
He created... Okay, so the Weekly Standard is this neoconservative right-wing magazine. It's an alternative to the National Review. The National Review comes from Bill Buckley in the 50s. The Weekly Standard was invented around in the 90s, and it was funded by Rupert Murdoch. And they preach, let the market decide, the free market, except when it comes to the Weekly Standard, there's no way that could make money on the free market. So it's going to be subsidized by the Koch brothers and Rupert Murdoch. And Bill Kristol, who is the son of Irving Kristol. Irving Kristol was a Trotskyite, was a left-leaning intellectual, wrote for Commentary. And under the Reagan administration, he became a Reagan Democrat, neoconservative. They're a new branch of the conservative movement. He had a change of heart, and his son, Bill Kristol, went with it. Bill Kristol, this piece of dung, became the publisher of the Weekly Standard. He was Dan Quayle's chief of staff. He advised Bob Dole to fight Hillary Care every step of the way back in 1994. Bill Kristol said, and there's a memo, you can look it up. Bill Kristol said to Bob Dole, who was the Senate majority leader, whatever you do, do not allow Hillary Care to pass because the American people will fall in love with Hillary Care.
Yep.
And there's no turning back. It will be a disaster for the Republicans. They will love Hillary Care the same way they love Medicare and Medicaid and Social Security. Fight her tooth and nail. That's part of his legacy. Then Bill Kristol, in the 90s, helped found this organization called PNAC, neoconservative, right-wing people who wanted the overthrow of Iraq so that America could establish a beachhead of democracy in Iraq, and that democracy would spread throughout the Middle East. But first we have to overthrow Saddam Hussein. And PNAC started in the 90s. Bill Kristol was behind this. David Frum. And when 9/11 happened, Bill Kristol stepped in. And, you know, Richard Pearl and David Frum, Wolfowitz, the whole Cheney, Bill Clinton was part of PNAC too. Hey, there's an opportunity for us. 9/11, let's link Saddam Hussein to 9/11. This was the plan from PNAC. Look it up. We'll invade Iraq now, establish a beachhead in Iraq, and spread democracy through the Middle East. He was the biggest champion. Bill Kristol was the biggest champion of the war in Iraq. Right? And he's still allowed on ABC Sunday morning with George Stephanopoulos. He's still allowed on Fox News. Still telling us to attack Iran. He is responsible for the deaths of 2 million Iraqis. That invasion of Iraq, according to Lancet, the British publication, the medical publication, Lancet is like the New England Journal of Medicine. 2 million Iraqis died from the invasion. Three quarters of Iraq has been displaced because of what America did to the Iraqi people. And Bill Kristol, if you want to isolate who is behind the invasion of Iraq, who invented it, who was the champion of it, it was Bill Kristol from the Weekly Standard. And when it went, when it turned into genocide, he didn't back down. He just said, we are making mistakes. We're not executing this war properly. And now he's trying to expiate his sins by attacking Trump. And all of a sudden, really smart people are thinking that Bill Kristol is a good guy without blood on his hands. And he needs to be reminded that he has blood on his hands because of Iraq. He has to live with Iraq. And I'm being muted by him on Twitter. So I'm asking my listeners to do the following. Look up Bill Kristol. Go to Wikipedia. Find out who Bill Kristol was. It's with a K. And we're going to have a Kristol knocked. I want my listeners to follow him on Twitter. And every time he posts something, remind him that he has the blood of 2 million Iraqis on his hands. And he doesn't get to clean himself by being against Trump. There are a lot of bad Republicans out there who are attacking Trump. And a lot of liberals are going, oh, this must be a good guy. He's a bad guy, Bill Kristol, the same way Arianna Huffington is a bad person.
And the comedian sucked.
That's a different Bill Kristol.
Sorry.
These are bad people. Follow Bill Kristol on Twitter, and every time he tweets, remind him that he has the blood of 2 million Iraqis on his hands. Let's plug some gigs.
And I just want to say one thing. We've been talking about it all night. As a liberal who wants to save this, I'm talking about saving this country. I'm not talking about defeating our enemies. I want to save this country. The only thing we can do is be better. In all seriousness, we have to be better. We have to be smarter. We have to be more ready. We have to be more prepared. We have to simply be the better. I prefer the term Ubermensch. We have to be the better people to win. We have to simply be above the ones we need to change the minds of.
I would say passive resistance. And if you're going to attack, as I just suggested, if you're going to use social media to attack the right people. Don't attack the guy who's about to lose his health insurance and doesn't know the difference between Obamacare and ACA. Go after Bill Kristol.
Yeah.
Pick your battles. Don't fight with potential voters. Just go after Bill Kristol. That's all you need to do. Channel all your rage at Bill Kristol. Find out who Bill Kristol is.
Spend the next 700 Sundays going after
yes,
Bill Kristol.
Attack the banks, not the Azealia banks. Though she's terrible.
All right. The show continues. Stay with us. Coming up, my conversation with Mattathias Schwartz from The Intercept about General Mattis, and my conversation with Jenny Rowland from American Progress. She wrote a brilliant article entitled How Exxon Won the 2016 Election. It'll really change the way you look at Trump's cabinet. You'll just see it as nothing more than a windfall for ExxonMobil. I want to remind you to subscribe to the show on iTunes or Stitcher. If you're listening to the show and you're laughing, listening, and learning, please give us a good review. It's especially important right now with what's going on that if you learned something from my show, Please copy the link, forward it to all your friends, pass it around, share the knowledge. You're not going to get this stuff on CNN. Yeah, you're just not going to get it anywhere else. There are very few places where you can hear this kind of stuff because we're not trafficking in sound bites. These are paragraphs. People are talking in paragraphs. Friend me on Facebook. Follow me on Twitter. Thank you for all your notes. I love hearing from my listeners. I appreciate the criticism. I love the compliments, but I do appreciate criticism, and I take all the criticism to heart. We're trying to make this show better, and it is getting better. Okay, let's get on with the show. Yeah, we're rolling, by the way, but I just want to tell you one thing. I was with, before we start, I was talking to some friends last night who were really anti-Trump. And they were saying, well, you know, once they start impeachment proceedings and, you know, they get Pence in there, and that's what the Senate really wants. And I'm thinking, I've had this conversation every month for the past 16 months, how Trump is not going to be president, you know, or he's going to be president for a week now and they're going to impeach him.
Yeah.
He's not going away, is he?
Yeah, it doesn't seem like either house of Congress is making any moves in that direction.
Yes,
yeah,
something else, we'll get to the show in a second, but something else is going on that I can't quite figure out. You know, somebody is behind this, or a group of people are behind this and propping him up, and they want him to be president no matter what. I guess so.
I hope so, I think. I'm not sure.
All right.
That's better or worse.
Yeah. Yeah. All right. This was for the podcast. This is the long-form version that we treat my listeners to. Now we'll get to the radio show. Welcome to the broadcast. Who really won last November's election? Obviously, Hillary did, but who really, really won it? Today's guest says it was ExxonMobil. On today's show, we're going to look at Trump's new cabinet through the prism of how they benefit ExxonMobil. Jenny Rowland is Research and Advocacy Associate for Public Lands at the Center for American Progress, and I contacted her after reading a piece she wrote entitled How Exxon Won the 2016 Election. I'll link to that article over at my website, but you should instead go to AmericanProgress.org and read the piece over there. She joins us today from Washington. Jenny, how big is ExxonMobil? It's been described as its very own nation.
ExxonMobil is one of the largest companies. It is actually the largest publicly traded oil company in the U.S. and is, I think, the eighth largest company in the world. And they, as far as energy development is concerned, they kind of have their hands in everything, oil, natural gas, tar sands, you name it. And that's, you know, kind of the largesse of this company is why we felt like they were really the ones that won the 2016 election.
I see their ads all the time. They're all about clean energy and alternative energy. According to the ads, they're good people. They ran into some problems about 2 years ago. The price of their stock went down. Why was ExxonMobil in danger during the lead up to the election, quote unquote, of Donald Trump?
So in 2014, their Securities and Exchange Commission, their SEC filings, showed that they might be in a little bit of trouble. And primarily that has to do with the fact that the price of oil was falling well below $100 per barrel. That's primarily how the company makes money. And so with that falling that low, they had predicted that for every dollar it fell below $100 per barrel, they would lose $150 million in earnings. So that's probably the, you know, the biggest reason that they were feeling, you know, in some trouble then. President Obama was also making some moves on some environmental regulations, which they had been fighting against. They were in a little bit of some hot water for investigations into what they knew about climate change that really were just starting to get going. But primarily it is the price of oil, and their price slid, I think, about 17% over 2 years.
And was that across the board for the entire sector, or was it specifically ExxonMobil? Were other energy stocks in trouble?
Yes. Overall, energy stocks were specifically oil. Natural gas in the U.S. was doing pretty well.
If the price of oil goes down, that means Exxon can't charge as much for it. But if we open up drilling rights, offshore drilling rights, or up in the Arctic, doesn't that increase the supply? So if there's an increase in supply, wouldn't the price go further down?
It would also drive up demand, though. Here, there's a number of things that could happen to drive up demand, and that's kind of how they make their money. And when oil prices are high, then they make more money.
Right. So more drilling actually increases demand?
Yes.
Okay. That's for another show. that's one of the reasons my listeners hate me, is I go off the beaten path and ask a stupid question that was irrelevant. Jenny, the former CEO of ExxonMobil is Trump's choice for Secretary of State. I call him Rex Spillerson. In reading your article, I realized there's more to the story than what happens when the former CEO of Exxon becomes Secretary of State. In fact, he may not even get confirmed. Marco Rubio was grilling him last week on Russia and Aleppo and suggested he may not even vote for him. But who knows what that's really about? He might have been grandstanding. But I'll get to Rex Spillerson becoming Secretary of State and how it's a windfall for Exxon and a disaster for our planet in a few minutes. By the time this interview is over, his name may have been withdrawn. Let's first tackle the Justice Department, the EPA, and the Department of Interior. I want to first get to the EPA, but let me read what you wrote. This is what you and your colleagues wrote in How Exxon Won the 2016 Election, which you can read over at AmericanProgress.org. You should go there every day. This is what you wrote. At no time in recent U.S. history has one company been at the brink of attaining so much power and influence over U.S. policy, both domestic and foreign. If the Senate confirms most or all of the five cabinet nominees whose backgrounds and positions would most benefit Exxon, the company will have acquired substantial direct and indirect control over the regulatory, law enforcement, lawmaking, and diplomatic powers of the American government. Wow. So, you know, I think Rex Spillerson is almost a distraction from all the other guys. I want to talk about the EPA, the pick for EPA, Scott Pruitt. But first, the Rockefeller family announced they are divesting themselves of all their holdings in Exxon. Tell my audience why they're divesting themselves of their holdings, and they'll better understand Scott Pruitt.
Some of the hot water that I talked about earlier that they've been in for denying climate change, science, and kind of even hiding the fact that they knew, that they've known about the dangers of climate change for years and have been hiding that, are some of the reasons that I think they are divesting, is they don't want to be associated with that kind of name and that those issues there. They've had some kind of publicly, they've said that they, you know, would support the Paris Climate Agreement, things like that, that they, the company believes that climate change is real, but, you know, more secretively and covertly, really, they've been funding climate science denial groups and different scientists, contrarian scientists, that will basically say that the dangers aren't real and that it's not happening. And so that's not something that big names like the Rockefellers want to be associated with.
Yeah, I read their letter. The Rockefeller family wrote an official letter. It was published in the New York Review of Books. One of the things I came to understand is that ExxonMobil, for the past 40 years, hired the top climate scientists in the world. You know, you always think NASA has the top climate scientists, but it was really Exxon. And about 40 years ago, they realized they were heating up the planet and knew there was a problem. And like the cigarette companies, they chose to bury that information, and the Rockefeller family, their fortune was built from ExxonMobil, and they're walking away from it. There are two attorney generals, state attorney generals, investigating ExxonMobil's role in hiding climate science. There is an attorney general from Oklahoma who Trump has nominated to be the new EPA administrator. His name is Scott Pruitt. Who is Scott Pruitt, and what has he done for or against ExxonMobil as attorney general of Oklahoma?
Yeah, so as you said, he is the attorney general of Oklahoma. He has been nominated by Trump to head the Environmental Protection Agency. Environmental protection is not exactly something that he's known for. He's sued the EPA a number of times in his career as AG of Oklahoma. But in regards to Exxon, as AG, he's gotten a number of campaign donations from the oil and gas industry, including more than $6,000 from Exxon specifically. And then you mentioned he wrote a letter defending Exxon, actually, against these charges that they had funded fraudulent climate science, that they have been denying the dangers of climate change that they have known about for decades, about 40 years. So he's come to their defense time and time again. And not necessarily surprisingly, because they're funding his campaign.
The EPA is a more recent cabinet position. I think it came about during the Nixon administration. And there's a lot of presidential power associated with the EPA. President Obama has proven that with the pen, without consulting Congress, he can do many things. What are some of the things that Trump could reverse over at EPA that would benefit ExxonMobil?
So I think the first thing would be the climate rule, the Clean Power Plan. Right now that's in the courts, and so that might not be directly under EPA right now, but that's where it came out of, and it could definitely go back there, and Pruitt could. That's one of the things that he has sued to get rid of, so presumably he would get rid of any attempts to curb carbon pollution. A couple of other things that might be in danger with a Pruitt nomination is the EPA methane rule. Methane is a lot stronger than carbon dioxide, but causes the same issues with global warming, just in a more concentrated amount. And EPA has recently made a rule that we would have to capture that. It's natural gas. It can be burned just like other natural gas and sold, but when it's just let to vent, it causes a lot of pollution. So that's one of the things that would be in danger. The ozone rule, ground level ozone, is bad for people's health, common in cities. That's another thing that would probably be targeted. And lastly, the clean water rule. And Exxon has publicly opposed all three of these rules. They've lobbied against them and put out statements that they would hurt their businesses, so presumably getting rid of them would help their business.
What is Exxon's role in fracking?
They definitely participate in fracking. It's, I think, one of their biggest businesses within the U.S. It's been growing, and you can drill for both oil and natural gas using fracking.
You wrote that they're one of the largest holders of natural gas in America, right?
They are one of the largest holders of natural gas, as well as one of the largest holders of Canadian tar sands,
right,
which is another fuel source, yes.
Right, and fracking involves water, shooting water deep below the Earth's surface, and the runoff, we are told, poisons wells, poisons groundwater. At first, the EPA said it didn't pose any harm to our drinking water. They've since reversed that, right? Recently, the EPA said, no, this could be bad for the drinking water. So we don't have good drinking water in America anymore. We have infrastructure problems, and it's not in ExxonMobil's best interest for us to be able to use tap water anymore. Okay, for Attorney General, we go to Jeff Sessions from, I believe, Alabama. It looks like he's going to be our attorney general. The Senate has been very kind to him because he's a senator. They tend to take care of their own. Has he been a friend of ExxonMobil?
He has. He's been really a longtime friend of ExxonMobil. Also, as a senator, has gotten many political contributions from Exxon, up to, I think, $10,000 from ExxonMobil, and then even more when you count kind of the entire oil and gas industry at large. And similar to Scott Pruitt, he's also written letters in support of ExxonMobil. This is specifically in relation to the investigations going on by the state attorney generals in Massachusetts and New York, the investigation that we discussed earlier. And he wrote a letter to the Department of Justice, which it looks like he'll be running soon, asking them to basically quash any investigation into Exxon on their knowledge of climate, the risks of climate change.
Which would just be a windfall for ExxonMobil to their bottom line. It would be like saying when the state attorney generals were ganging up on the tobacco industry a couple decades ago, and there was this amazing settlement that supposedly went to states to help with health care, to pay damages for cigarettes. It would be the equivalent of an attorney general in a Justice Department trying to stop the tobacco companies from being sued by state attorney generals for hiding the evidence that they were manipulating nicotine levels and that they knew cigarettes were cancerous before the public did.
Exactly.
Yeah, this is...
And that's,
go ahead.
I was just going to say, and there's a lot of parallels between this investigation and the settlement reached with the tobacco industry about, you know, just kind of fundamentally misleading the public about the harms of its products, carbon pollution being for ExxonMobil. Another thing, recent settlement, that we compare this to is the Volkswagen case where they were polluting and cheating the system basically on their pollution. And they just settled for $14.7 billion. And that was for lying about polluting over 7 years. And so if you kind of multiply that by the 40 years that Exxon has allegedly lied about the knowledge of climate change, then that's a pretty hefty sum for them.
We didn't really give the Obama administration enough time. 8 years wasn't enough. There was something beginning to happen that started under Holder and then Lynch at the Justice Department, where they began to prosecute corporations. You know, they put the private colleges, they didn't necessarily put them out of business, but they put a lot of private universities out of business. They're kind of putting private prisons out of business. And I was getting really optimistic that if Hillary became president, this would continue and we'd see something that we really have not seen for decades. I don't even think we saw it under the Clinton administration, where the Justice Department began to say, OK, if corporations are people, then the people in those corporations are, well, not going to go to prison, but they're going to be fined. We're going to go after them. We were beginning to see that recently, weren't we?
Yeah, absolutely.
And we're not going to see that now. This is a new, he's basically putting people in charge of cabinet positions that they want eliminated. For example, Rick Perry, the former governor of Texas, the longest serving governor of Texas. He's been nominated to run the Department of Energy. That's the department he couldn't remember. He had three departments he wanted to eliminate during his 2012 debate oops moment. So it's always good for Exxon when a mouth breather is running energy. Why is this especially good for Exxon if this specific intellectual lightweight, Rick Perry, is running energy?
Yes, running energy and our nuclear weapons as well. A lot of what and nuclear energy is what they work on a lot there. So as kind of we've talked about a lot, all of these nominees in these kind of critical cabinet positions have been funded in their political roles by ExxonMobil, and Rick Perry's no different. He has taken $40,000 just in his most recent gubernatorial election from ExxonMobil. And in his role at Department of Energy, if he's confirmed, he would be, you know, overseeing a lot of research into ExxonMobil's competitors in alternative fuels and electric vehicles. And so that kind of stuff could really go away without funding being directed towards it.
I read in your article that Exxon is against electric vehicles because the ads that I see, they're championing all these alternative fuel sources. And your article says that they're against electric vehicles?
In the United Kingdom, at least, they have lobbied pretty hard against electric vehicles there. And in their SEC reports here, they've noted that alternative fuels are a threat to their business.
So their ads, they're not telling the truth in their ads. Surprising. One of the things I do, I'm probably going to get kicked off Twitter. I keep getting these promoted tweets from Exxon on my feed. So I tweet back to them, you know, you're destroying our planet. You're pathological liars. The only government building Rex Spillerson should be invited into is a prison cell. I have a feeling Twitter's good. I have not been successful on Twitter. I've been more successful on Facebook. Hey, I've turned this conversation. It's all about me, not the planet. It's my Twitter followers, my number of Twitter followers. Okay, this is going to, I'm going to get to Rex Spillerson in a second. Let's eat our vegetables. This is going to be hard. So we're going to, this is, I don't know if I'm going to understand this. President-elect Trump's nominee to lead the Department of Interior is Montana Congressman Ryan Zinke. This involves the leasing of public lands and royalty rates. My eyes glaze over. It's hard stuff. And when it's hard stuff, that's when the Republicans, they insinuate themselves into the difficult stuff. So we can't pay attention, and they steal everything from us. So we need to know this. Help me. What does the Department of Interior do? What are public lands and royalty rates? What's going on here? Because I know this is where we're going to wake up one day and find out that's where all of the damage was done.
Absolutely. And I work on public lands primarily is what I work on. And I think you're right that some of these things can be very confusing. And that's really where they try and get you on it when it's a little bit too confusing to figure out right away. And so one of the things that the Department of Energy does is they manage all taxpayer-owned natural resources.
Department of Interior.
Oh, Department of Interior. Sorry, I misspoke. They manage all taxpayer-owned natural resources on public lands. So public lands, most people know national parks, national forests, things like that, wildlife refuges. Those are all public lands. And then there's Bureau of Land Management lands, which are also public lands, and they're popular for hiking and outdoor recreation. But they also are used for oil and gas production, for alternative energy production as well.
Is the Bureau of Land Management underneath the Department of Interior?
Part of the Department of the Interior. And so they lease these lands to companies like ExxonMobil to drill and get oil and gas from, and we charge royalties on those that go to taxpayers. And those royalties are very low and haven't actually been changed in over 30 years. ExxonMobil is one of the companies that leases lands, and I think a couple of years ago they leased about, I don't know, almost $4 billion of taxpayer resources. And we get about 12% is what taxpayers get on that. And so if those royalty rates are either not changed, the Department of the Interior under Obama has been looking to increase those to kind of make it more fair for taxpayers, because those numbers are very, very low when you compare them to, say, state or private land leasing. And so if those numbers under Representative Ryan Zinke are lowered, the royalty rate numbers are lowered, or they are left the same, then that can put a lot of money back into the pockets of Exxon and other oil and gas companies.
But if you listen to CNN or Fox or even MSNBC, except for Rachel Maddow, when they talk about the Department of Interior and they talk about the Bureau of Land Management, they'll only tell us about the Bundy standoff, Cliven Bundy and his grazing rights and sovereign nations and people seceding. A great distraction from what's really important, which is the pillaging of our natural resources. All right. Thank you for explaining that to me. And, you know, it's just something you have to just stick with it and read about it every day. And eventually it begins to make sense. Let's get to Rex Spillerson. I didn't realize this until I read your article, and everybody should read this article. It's over at theamericanprogress.org. I realized after reading your article that Rex Spillerson being named to be Secretary of State was a red herring, a distraction, so people wouldn't notice the other ExxonMobil puppets who are being installed within the cabinet. So Rex Spillerson, if he becomes Secretary of State, how does that benefit ExxonMobil?
So I think, yeah, in the obvious way that he has been a lifelong Exxon employee, most recently their CEO, it's tough to believe that maybe he would be looking out for the best interests of everyday Americans rather than still holding on to some of his corporate interests. And so as Secretary of State, his relationships with other countries is primarily how he could benefit ExxonMobil. While he's not there, Exxon produces oil and gas in 22 countries, and I think most recently have had plans to expand that. We also know that Rex Tillerson has close ties to Russia. That's what, during his confirmation hearing, that he got questioned on that a lot. And there is a lot of oil and gas in Russia and a lot of oil and gas that ExxonMobil would like to be further producing but haven't been able to right now because of U.S. sanctions against Russia.
We put in sanctions against Russia after they seized Crimea, which maybe they're entitled to. Some say they had every right to take Crimea. And we ended up blocking a pipeline that Putin wanted and Exxon wanted. If he becomes Secretary of State, pipelines fall under the purview of state, like the big pipeline from the Canadian tar sands that we're still waiting to hear about, right?
Exactly. So international pipelines are also under the purview of the Secretary of State. And the most famous one is, I think, that you referenced is the Keystone XL pipeline that President-elect Trump has talked a lot about. As Secretary of State, Tillerson could, you know, speed up the approval of international pipelines. And that would help Exxon because they have a lot of stock in the Canadian tar sands. I think about 35% of their holdings most recently were in tar sands. So getting those to market could really be a windfall for them.
So aggravating. It really is.
It is. And I think you're right that in some ways, you know, a little bit of a red herring, it seems so obvious that Rex Tillerson might help benefit ExxonMobil. But really, Trump has seemed to try and stock his cabinet with as many people funded by the oil and gas industry, and even ExxonMobil in particular, that they could really have some impactful decisions for future of the company.
Yeah. How do you keep from being overwhelmed by all this information? How do you keep your head on straight? Because it's definitely a concerted effort by Trump and Bannon and Kushner. They're really manipulating the public, just throwing so much stuff at us. It's like a document dump. There's just so much corruption. You can't, your head is spinning. How do you stay focused and not just, how do you get out of bed?
Yeah. I don't know that I do, but I don't know that I have a great answer for that, except for that you're completely right. I mean, this Wednesday they had Trump's first press hearing in so long, and they had Tillerson going and Sessions going and Congress doing a Votorama trying to repeal Obamacare. So we're seeing almost every single one of these cabinet nominees that I mentioned are having hearings one day after the next. I think it's Zanke on Tuesday, Pruitt on Wednesday, and Rick Perry on Thursday. And so it really is just a, you know, a document dump that try and get a handle on and try and pick out what's really most important.
Before you go, I want to look up Halliburton, which was Dick Cheney's company. I'm going to find out its price performance. Let me just see for a second. This is so Halliburton was Dick Cheney's company, and he was made vice president and he left Halliburton. All right, so when in 2000, the price of Halliburton's stock was $19.22. When Dick Cheney, on January 18th of 2002, it dropped to $5 a share. By 2005, it was up to $36. It hit a new high. By June 27th of 2008, it went up to $52 a share. So when he left office, it was worth $52. So when he took office, it was $21 a share. When he left, it doubled in 8 years. That's
not nothing.
That's not nothing. Well, and you're not nothing. Jenny Rowland is Research and Advocacy Associate for Public Lands at the Center for American Progress. Her recent piece, How Exxon Won the 2016 Election, is available over at AmericanProgress.org. She joined us today from Washington. Thank you for being so generous with your time.
Yeah, thank you for having me on.
Coming up, my conversation with Mattathias Schwartz. Please friend me on Facebook, follow me on Twitter, do all your Amazon shopping via the David Feldman Show website. Don't forget, for as little as $5 a month, you can support this show by becoming a monthly subscriber. We take all major credit cards. When you're a monthly subscriber, you get free access to all our premium content. Donald Trump nominated General James N. Mattis, a retired Marine, for Defense Secretary, calling him the closest America has to a General Patton. General Mattis, 66, was a four-star general and as head of the United States Central Command from 2010 to 2013. He was deemed too hawkish on Iran and for that reason was fired by President Obama. One of the stumbling blocks to Mattis running defense is the 1947 National Security Act mandating that the Secretary of Defense be appointed from civilian life. Mattathias Schwartz writes for The Intercept, and he joins us today from Capitol Hill. The Senate Armed Service Committee hearings on the Mattis waiver are just wrapping up. Very quickly, what is the Mattis waiver?
So General Mattis needs Congress to pass a waiver in order to become Secretary of Defense due to the 1947 law you mentioned, which says you have to be out of the armed services. Well, initially it said 10 years, and that was later reduced to 7 years. And Mattis has only been up for three or four years. So Congress has to pass a new law for him to become Secretary of Defense. And instead of the normal 51 votes that an appointee would need from the Senate, he actually needs 60. In order to get that law on the books and clear the way for him to be in charge of the Pentagon under Trump.
And that's what the hearings so far have been about?
Well, this hearing was preliminary. Mattis was not there. It was with a couple of academics, experts. One was Dr. Elliot Cohen, talking about where this law came from and the history of civilian control of the military in the U.S.
The other one was Kathleen Hicks, I believe.
That's right.
And these are being chaired by...
By Senator John McCain. It's the Senate Armed Services Committee, and he's the chair. And I believe they were called at the behest of Senator Reed of Rhode Island.
Will the waiver be passed before or after General Mattis testifies before the committee?
It's unclear. It seems likely that it would be after. But, you know, the Senate is in session now. And it's not altogether clear.
Right.
I will also have to pass Congress for the break that fast tracks the legislation, and we'll make that process.
I'm sorry, you were breaking up a little. Say that again, please.
Congress passed a bill before the break that fast tracked the legislation, and will make the process easier.
Senate rules are a little Byzantine, so go over that for me. First of all, I haven't read the Constitution recently. Confirmation is only the purview of the Senate when it comes to defense secretary.
That's right. But in order for General Mattis to become defense secretary, there actually needs to be a new law sort of setting aside this requirement that the Secretary of Defense be out of military service for 7 years.
So this would be the 1947 National Security Act that needs to be rewritten.
Yeah, or there needs to be a new law. You know, I think the law that they're talking about now would be a very narrowly tailored exception that would say the next person who is appointed Secretary of Defense who meets these, you know, criteria, this law would not apply to. So it would be a one-time exception to the 47 law.
Right now, the Senate rules require a majority for a Secretary of Defense.
That's right. That's right. In order to pass this law, you would need to have 60 votes. So the Democrats could block it because you need 60 votes to invoke cloture and prevent a filibuster. Now, Senator Gillibrand of New York has said that she's going to oppose the waiver. So there does appear to be one senator who potentially would be ready to block it. So they'll need 60 to pass this law and give him the waiver.
You know, one of the reasons a lot of Americans don't pay attention is it is complicated. So I just want to spell this out, if you don't mind. In order for General Mattis to be approved by the Senate, the new rules are just a simple majority.
That's right. But he it's unclear whether he would be constitutionally allowed to assume the office if he were in violation of this 1947 statute requiring that the Secretary of Defense come from civilian life. So there's two things that have to happen. One, the Senate has to confirm him. And two, Congress has to pass a new law granting him a waiver for this 1947 prohibition. If they don't pass the law, it's unclear whether he'd be able to become Secretary of Defense legally.
So just that we're clear here, it requires 60 votes to pass the waiver, but 51 votes for him to be confirmed as Secretary of Defense. Elliot Cohn, he's a professor of strategic studies at Johns Hopkins University, testified today on behalf of the waiver. He says that Mattis would act as a stabilizing force on Trump's watch. How much should people who don't like Trump trust somebody like General Mattis?
I don't know if it's ever a good idea to trust the government. Trust is a dangerous word. Mm-hmm. I think Dr. Cohen does have a point that General Mattis is among the more experienced and moderate of Trump's appointments so far. There have been reports that he actually wanted to make Michelle Flournoy, who was widely perceived to be Hillary Clinton's choice for Secretary of Defense, his deputy, and that she actually met with the president-elect to discuss that and decided that she didn't want to. So he has been, you know, nearly as moderate and apolitical as most folks in senior positions in the military are these days, far more so than Trump's other military appointees, Michael Flynn, his national security advisor, and John Kelly, his choice for the Department of Homeland Security.
Well, they call him Mad Dog. And when somebody compares a general to Patton, my reading of history is that Patton wasn't the sanest of our military.
Yeah, Cohen said that he'd never heard anyone use the Mad Dog, you know, appellation. Mm-hmm. We know that General Mattis travels with a library of 6,000 books. He's written some pretty eloquent emails about the importance of reading. If you did want to look at his record, the thing to look at would be his conduct of the taking of Fallujah in the early part of the Iraq War. He was the Marine general who George W. Bush charged with taking back the city, and there have been, you know, a lot of allegations that that there were, you know, unnecessary civilian casualties. There were, you know, more than 1,000 insurgents hiding out in Fallujah, and, you know, urban warfare is not a pretty thing. But that would be the one aspect of his record that, you know, that if you wanted to push those questions, that Congress could focus on.
Did torture happen on his watch in Iraq?
Not that we know of. And he came down pretty hard on Abu Ghraib, which I believe he was sort of tangentially connected to in command. Of course, Trump has said that Mattis has changed his mind, at least to some degree, on whether waterboarding, which is a form of torture, should be brought back. You know, he said that to the New York Times a few weeks ago, which is part of why people have been so supportive of the Mattis nomination. The sense that he could, the sense that he could moderate the president-elect's views.
He had a mea culpa with Abu Ghraib, right? He called it one of the most embarrassing moments, if not the most embarrassing moment of his career, right?
Yeah, I believe that he did. I think that is correct.
He has come out against waterboarding, but now President-elect, boy, that's hard to trip off the tongue. President-elect Donald Trump says that he's changed his mind on waterboarding, or has he pretty much remained steadfast opposed to waterboarding?
No. President-elect Trump said that Mattis changed Trump's mind, at least to some degree, on waterboarding. In his interview with the New York Times editorial board, he said that he just met with General Mattis, and that Mattis said that he could do better with a pack of cigarettes and a couple cans of beer than with waterboarding if he were interrogating, an Al Qaeda prisoner. And a lot has been made of this remark by Trump. And people have sort of turned that into a suggestion that Trump's own views about torture may be moderating and that Mattis could potentially be a stabilizing force on his thinking. But that's really all we get from Trump, is just these kind of like throwaway moments and quotes and tweets and little glimpses. And I don't think anyone really knows what his opinions about these things are and who will really be part of his inner circle. Now, of course, the Secretary of Defense is part of like the National Security Committee. The Secretary of Defense is one of the principals. So if the Trump White House looks anything like those before it, you know, he will be one of the people in the room when the big decisions get made. Now, will Trump abide by that precedent? He's certainly set many others aside. So, you know, who knows? It's all kind of up for grabs at this point.
Mattathias Schwartz writes for The Intercept. You have a great article about the Mattis waiver. President-elect Trump went to the military academy as an adolescent, but never served in our military. He seems to get his information from the shows, doesn't read, loves the movie Patton, and we're hoping that he's not really going to be in charge, right? He's going to kind of play the king, and Vice President-elect Pence will be the prime minister, and that Trump really won't be making the important decisions in the Situation Room. That'll be left to the generals. That's not what our founding fathers wanted, and we'll get to that in a second because you write a lot about that. But is that what they're hoping for on Capitol Hill, even the Republicans, that Donald Trump kind of just tweets in the Situation Room while the adults are in charge?
Well, that is what the transition, that is what Trump's campaign reportedly told Governor John Kasich of Ohio when they offered him the job of vice president. They told him that if Trump won, he would be the most powerful vice president in history, and that Trump wasn't really that engaged in day-to-day things. I find that hard to believe. I think Trump's whole identity and brand, which is the thing he's most obsessed with, is focused solely on him being in charge. And I find it, I think there'll be things that he isn't interested in, and that will be an important, area of his administration to watch. But in terms of the big issues, I find it hard to believe that he won't be putting his personal stamp on all of them and letting everyone know that he's the boss. That seems to be what his whole life is about.
Well, you write some really leading questions in The Intercept about this mutiny and the need for generals to follow the orders of their president. In The Intercept, you write that the Senate Armed Services Committee needs to ask General Mattis what his stance is on mutiny and whether or not a general is obligated to follow the orders of our president.
There's sort of this issue of muscle memory if he served in the military, will he see a president and a sort of colleague in whose cabinet he's serving in and who constitutionally he's going to give advice to, or will he see a commander-in-chief to take orders from? Now, one thing I didn't say in this story that's important to note is that there's a difference in the oath that enlisted men in the military take and the oath that officers take. Enlisted men swear an oath to follow the orders of command. Officers simply take an oath to uphold the Constitution. they don't actually swear an oath to follow orders. So they do have a different culture, and there is a larger degree of independence and republicanism that runs through the officer corps. And I think Mattis has done enough reading to know that. But it is something that the Congress needs to keep an eye on.
Yeah, I want to – I hate to use the term unpack, but I do want to unpack this. During the Oliver North Contrigate hearings, I remember Oliver North being told that after the Nuremberg trials, it was enshrined in the military that you are not supposed to obey orders if they're illegal. Because after World War II, a lot of the Nazi generals say, I was just following orders. And the takeaway from that experience was that American soldiers were not allowed to just follow orders if those orders were deemed illegal. What is the difference between mutiny and not following orders that you deem illegal?
Well, the problematic word in that question is illegal, because there's a lot of awful things that President Trump could do under certain readings of executive authority that are perfectly legal, such as launch a quote-unquote preemptive nuclear strike against someone who he deems to be a threat, or such as torture. You know, we've seen the memos from the Office of Legal Counsel written during the term of President George W. Bush by John Yoo explaining why waterboarding is not torture, even though we all know that it is, and multiple independent bodies have found that it is. So that the president, to a great extent, is capable of making his own law, principally through the Office of Legal Counsel. So the question is not so much whether Mattis would follow, you know, illegal orders, but just whether the extent to which he'd be able to flex his own judgment and change the actions, you know, flowing from an office whose powers have grown tremendously. I mean, we saw, you know, sort of a great wave of executive power that got curtailed in Watergate, and then there was a second wave that got curtailed, you know, during the Iran-Contra affair. And now we're at the crest of a third wave, and it still hasn't been pushed back. And you can look at some of the precedents that President Obama has set with his own OLC findings, and some of them are quite frightening.
Under Rumsfeld, he kind of ran the military as his own little country. He dismissed the Republican Guard in Iraq. President Bush didn't even know that. The greatest mistake that was made, the reason ISIS rose up is because Hussein's army was dismissed in Iraq, and President Bush found out about that ex post facto.
Right.
Is that what Mattis is just going to do? Is he just going to not consult Trump? I mean, go back to mutiny. What constitutes mutiny in the Constitution?
Well, this is just the reading of the Commander-in-Chief clause, is that acting as Commander-in-Chief, you know, the President has authority over the armed services. Mm-hmm. That doesn't apply to the Secretary of Defense. It is a civilian role, and it is part of the President's cabinet. So there's no requirement that Mattis obey the President. In terms of what Rumsfeld did with Bush,
you said there is no what, that he obeys the President?
There's no constitutional requirement that as Secretary of Defense he carry out the President's orders. Now, if he doesn't, the President can dismiss him, of course. But it's not illegal for him to not follow orders in the same way that it would be for like an enlisted soldier, because he will be serving in a civilian role, even though he is a former general.
Well, that's really important. It is not. He's not constitutionally mandated to follow the Commander-in-Chief's orders, because he's a civilian, not a member of the military. So legally, if he doesn't follow the President's orders, the worst that can happen to him is he gets fired?
Yeah, that's right. Yeah.
That's,
I mean, it's his job. It's his job to carry out the President's policies. But it's no different from the Secretary of Health and Human Services or the Secretary of Labor. It's a purely civilian relationship between the Secretary of Defense and the President, and it's not something that he could be court-martialed for. It's not a violation of the Uniform Code of Military Justice. Even though he is a retired general, as Secretary of Defense, he'll be there. It'll be a civilian job. The Secretary of Defense will remain a civilian job.
And that's baked into the Federalist Papers, you write. What did our founding fathers believe when it came to civilian rule of the military?
They were afraid of standing armies. That was one of their big complaints. It's against the English rule, is these big standing armies that were kept everywhere. They felt that was a threat to republicanism, and they wanted a small volunteer army that would expand in times of crisis. Now, we kind of set that aside after World War II. We never really demilitarized after World War II. We've been trying to run at least half the world since then. Some of these concepts are a little bit antique. The one that isn't is that the military is not autonomous. It's controlled by the president and, to a lesser degree lately, by Congress, which sets its budget. And then it can only appropriate budgets to the military for 2 years at the most. That's in the Constitution. So the military takes direction from two branches of government, the executive and the legislative, and it is not autonomous. It's not capable of giving itself orders. Those orders flow down mostly from the president.
We've been talking with Mattathias Schwartz. You are a reporter for The Intercept. And do you specialize in military? What do you specialize in over there?
I'm a national security reporter for The Intercept. I contribute to The New Yorker and The New York Times Magazine as well.
Great. Thank you so much for your time. I'll let you get back to the hearings. I hope you'll come back real soon.
Yeah, I'd love to. Thank you. It's a pleasure. Thanks for getting down into the nuts and bolts of this.
Thank you.
I want to thank Jenny Rowland from American Progress, Mattathias Schwartz from The Intercept, Bob Powers and Dave Sirus, two great comedy writers. You all made this a perfect show. Thank you. Again, if you enjoyed any portion of this show, please copy and paste the link and post it to Dig, StumbleUpon, Facebook, Twitter. Send it to your friends, your relatives. Share the information. Share the knowledge. Become a monthly subscriber for as little as $5 a month. You can gain access to our premium content for $5 a month. Did I mention that you should do all your Amazon shopping via the David Feldman Show website? It doesn't cost you more money. Friend me on Twitter, follow me on Facebook, go to my website, look around. We got great stuff. Hey, we're going to get through this. We are. You're going to see. It's going to be our finest moment. Trust me. This is going to be America's finest moment. Monica Crowley, gone. We got rid of her. This is going to be America's finest moment. From the Showbiz Studios in downtown Manhattan, that'll do it for us.
The David Feldman radio program is made possible by listeners like you. You sad, pathetic humps.